Before we start, just a reminder that on March 25th at Harvard, there's going to be a colloquium by Brian Conrad. So I'd like to start this off by providing just a little bit of context about my relationship with Professor Zuckerman. During my childhood, I had a peculiar and relentless obsession with the human brain. It was my singular aspiration to one day understand this complex neural network that lives in all of us. However, as I grew older, my focus shifted from understanding the brain itself to utilizing my own in an attempt to understand the monumentally complex universe in which I found myself living. And it was a strive that would eventually compel me to undertake the study of mathematics. And it was not until I was in high school that I became aware that my mother's cousin, Gregg Zuckerman, felt a similar drive. His outstanding research in the fields of mathematical physics, representation theory of groups, and now logic has been driven by that same desire to understand the universe. His excellence led him to speak on Lie groups at the highly prestigious International Congress of Mathematicians in 1978. A year ago, mathematicians from all over the world met at Yale University to honor him for a certain milestone birthday of his. And a certain number. And
it's online.
It's online, you could find it. I'm not gonna spoil it. And on October 2008, he published a paper entitled The Mathematical Foundations of Consciousness. And I can't forget the day I read the abstract, because on one level, it seamlessly combined my two strongest childhood interests, mathematics and the brain. But more importantly, it strengthened and solidified the familial bonds between myself and Professor Zuckerman. To this aspiring undergraduate, he became an inspiration. So, in closing, to contemplate is to be conscious, but to contemplate consciousness with the rigor and insight of Gregg Zuckerman is to be a great philosopher, a great mathematician, and a monumental thinker. So without further ado, it's my privilege to introduce my cousin, Gregg Zuckerman.
I want to thank Yale for that wonderful introduction. Build on what Yale was saying. There are many people, maybe some of you here, who have been looking for a theory of everything, but in my opinion, and I think in the opinion of many, many more people as time goes by, there will not be a theory of everything until it includes a theory of consciousness. So I have kind of moved on from ordinary mathematical physics to what you might call brain physics. And so obviously none of you are doing string theory, so you don't get the you don't get the joke, but all right, so I won't talk about brains in quantum physics. And I'm not even 100% I'm going to talk 100% sure I'm going to talk about the human brain. But I am interested in the relationship between mathematics and the theory of neural networks, and I'm glad that that Yale made the reference to that topic. Whether or not consciousness can actually arise from a theory of neural networks is extremely controversial. And I think people thought about this for a long time. But what's happened in my work with my co-author, Willard Marenker, who is also in Yale, but actually in the comp sci department. We've realized that there's some sort of an uncanny parallel between the theory of neural networks and a potential theory for consciousness. So that's what I'm proposing to explain today. And so this all has to be mediated by a new model of set theory. Now, of course, nothing is completely new in mathematics. The work goes under the term nonwellfounded sets. And this has probably a long history, but the principal name, and so I included the name in the abstract, is Peter Aczel from England. And he has a monograph from about 1988 explaining this new model of set theory. Now, by the way, Branker and I have published several papers on the subject of a mathematical theory of consciousness. The first one is in, as Yale mentioned, October 2008 on the archive. So let me spell Will's name correctly. There aren't too many Marenkers, and there aren't that many Zuckermans, and so you combine Marenker and Zuckerman, and there's a unique paper. That's how you find it. All right, so I'm just curious. Is there anybody here who knows what a non-well-founded set is? Okay, so there, it's not a generally known concept even among students and professionals. On the other hand, suppose I asked you, have you ever seen a set which is an element of itself? Well, how about the set of all concepts? In some intuitive way, that seems to be a set which contains itself as an element. And this theory of non-well-founded sets sort of begins with playing around with the idea of sets that don't behave the way sets behave in ordinary mathematics. So here's a very simple example of a non-well-founded set. And it's called the Quine atom. I believe that Quine was a professor at Harvard at one time, maybe even spoke in this colloquium at one time. And the Quine atom is usually symbolized by the Greek letter omega. And omega has exactly one element, which is itself. Now, you may say this is absurd. You've never seen such an object in mathematics. Such an object couldn't exist.